Okay, welcome back. So we have the third lecture about cosmic rays.
Okay. Is it on? Okay, so I left you yesterday with the suspense of what is happening to a charged particle in a magnetic field which has a large regular component oriented, and then there is some stochastic fluctuation on top of it, which it does sense to analyze in the direction which is orthogonal to the direction of orientation of the large scale field. And we also made this, haven't given you the full justification, but we suspect that this stochastic fluctuation is associated to some velocity which is smaller compared to the speed of light and the velocity of the particle itself. And we said, okay, it's a particle in a magnetic field, so its energy is fixed. So we don't have to look at how the modulus of the momentum varies, but we have to look how the direction of this particle is changing. And the equation, we write it in form of an equation for the pitch angle, which is just the projection, which just gives the projection of the momentum on this direction parallel to the magnetic field. So the equation, I rewrote it here. And now I want to make a little bit of a gymnastic to see when this variation of the pitch angle gets significant. So I want to make the computation on the blackboard, so I have to go in some simple limit. And let me restrain, first of all, to a stochastic perturbation which is associated to one single mode. Okay? One mode which has some given wavelength, so it's associated to some given frequency. And then let me write this, the component. So I took B in the direction Z. Let me write the component of B, delta BX, delta BY. And I write it in a form which is the following. So there is some amplitude. And then I just glue here a cosine of kz plus some phase psi. And here I take this to be sine of kz plus psi. So this is psi, is some arbitrary phase I'm going to average on in a second. So if I just plug it in here, okay, I choose the phase in such way that I get a nice cosine of omega t cosine of this argument plus sine, the two sine of the same arguments. So then I can go back to my trigonometry course. I have the cosine of angle B, A cosine of the angle B plus sine of the angle A sine the angle B. And then this is what? This is just the cosine of angle A minus B. Okay? So if I take that and I substitute in this, I get that the evolution of the pitch angle is just Q divided by M gamma C, square root of 1 minus mu square, And then I have this cosine of omega t minus kz minus psi. Okay? And then I remember that the motion in the z direction is not touched by the large-scale magnetic field, so this z I will just write as the velocity of the particle in the direction of the magnetic field, so I project it out again with the cosine of the angle, and then times t. Okay, so this is just u divided by m gamma c, 1 minus mu squared, the cosine of omega minus v mu k t minus psi. Okay? Fine. So I have something that now I need to average over this psi, which is, as I said before, a random phase. I want to perform the average of what is this delta mu that I connect that I get connected to that. So you see, if I just average it like that, then I have an average over psi of this cosine of psi. So clearly, the average of the variation of the pitch angle is zero. Okay? That's not really what I'm after, because this is a variation which has zero average, but what about the variance? Okay, so to compute the variance, I need to compute this product here. This product here is q squared, m squared, gamma squared, c squared, 1 minus mu squared. And then, okay, I'm getting some finite delta mu, so I have to integrate over some time t prime this cosine of omega minus v mu k t prime minus psi, and then I integrate over d second prime cosine of omega minus v mu k t second minus psi. Okay? And just notice that I did a little trick. So I applied this integration over time to the terms that are fastly varying time. So there is some time variation also here, but I'm assuming that this difference here is small, so over that fast variation I can take that off, that out of the integration. Okay, and then I wrote it like this because I go back again to my trigonometry book, and the cosine of A cosine of B is equal to 1/2 of the cosine of A plus B plus the cosine of A minus B. Okay? Yeah, sorry. Okay. It's very possible that I get some of these wrong. So if you spot mistakes, Just wave the end. Okay. So, okay. So this is something that goes in like m squared, gamma squared, c squared, 1 minus mu squared, the integration over dt prime, d second prime, and then I have the two terms, put a factor of 2 here. I have the term in which I have the sum, cosine of, like that. Cosine of, omega minus mu v k. Then I have t prime plus t second prime minus 2 psi plus the cosine of omega minus v mu k t prime minus t second prime, and the psi is gone. Okay, so this is parenthesis, this is parenthesis. Okay. Then clearly I did like that because when I take the variance of this over this random phase, the term that still contains the psi goes while the other stays. Okay, so this first term here just drops. This second term, let me do some extra little basic gymnastic, which is the following. Let me use the representation of the cosine of some product small a times t. This is just the exponential of I a t plus e to the I to the minus I a t divided by 2. And then you see that t is integrated over. So I can use the integral representation of the delta function. The delta function of small a is 1 divided by 2 pi, the integral in dt between minus infinity and plus infinity of this e to the I a t. Okay? So when I take this variance, I take this variance in a limit in which I'm integrating over a time interval which is, so to speak, large. And then what do I get from here? I get this first term, q squared divided by twice m squared gamma squared c squared, 1 minus mu squared. And then I get from this, the integration over this term, I just get 2 pi delta of omega minus mu v k. Okay? So I pick a preferred frequency, and exactly I can define some resonance wave number, which is just defined like the combination that I get from this delta function, omega divided by pitch angle times velocity. And remind you that this omega is what is reflecting the large-scale magnetic field I'm sitting into is the Larmor frequency, so it's B is Q B naught divided by gamma MC. So I get, sorry, you see, I did a mistake here. I integrated over one of the two time integration to get this delta function. Then I have the integration over the other time, which gives me a delta t. So now if I just compute this variance per unit time, that's as an expression which is just what I get it from here. So this delta function of omega minus v mu k is just 1 divided by v mu delta function of k minus k resonance. Put everything together and find that I have this variance pi q squared v 1 minus mu squared divided by c squared p squared mu, and then delta b, the modulus of delta b squared, delta of k minus k resonance. So mysteriously, the delta b is reappearing back, and I forgot it since the very beginning. Okay, sorry, there was a modulus of delta b here, and then I had it delta b squared here, sorry. And since I copied it, this should be okay. Okay, so if I want to write explicitly that something in terms of a delta b squared normalized to the background field squared, then you see there's some combination which comes in, and which, okay, this b squared is hidden in this omega. I can introduce omega, and at the end of the day, I get a k resonance times omega, and then a factor of pi 1 minus mu squared in front, delta of k minus k resonance. Okay, so I'm almost there, because, now I did this exercise for one mode, and I get a variance which is non-negligible when this mode resonate on this K resonance. In general, I will have a power spectrum of modes. Right, so I will have a P of K, which will be some distribution of I'm not sure you see it here. Maybe I should go back to the other side. So I have a superposition of alpha in waves with a given power spectrum of perturbations with respect to the mean field. And then the correct way of normalizing it is to put 1 over 4 pi there and 1 over 8 pi here. And then you see, when I go and compute this variance, I have this resonance criterion, which puts me on having the variance to be something like pi 1 minus mu squared. And I have omega k resonance, the integral over dk of this power spectrum. So that's why I wrote explicitly this combination here. That's this except for a factor of 2. And then I have the resonance condition. So this variance is picking for the various modes, this resonant mode, and I just get that the final formula is this with power spectrum computed at the resonance K. This result we just got is a result for the variance of the pitch angle, which is usually defined to be twice the so-called diffusion coefficient in pitch angle. So this is telling you, on average, p mu mu is telling you which is, on average, the variance over delta theta, the angle itself, in a time interval per unit time. So if I am looking at delta theta, I'm looking at this delta mu over the sine of the angle, which is here. So that is just equal to pi divided by 4 omega k resonance p of k resonance. So, okay, so we get that this particle is responding to the background in this way. What's the physical meaning of the formula that I wrote it there? What is this K resonance again? This K resonance is just omega divided by mu v. So it's 1 divided by mu times the Larmor radius. Okay? And then why am I looking at modes that match this Larmor radius. Why am I looking at physical scales which are of this kind? Well, you can visually look at that in this way. Suppose first that you are sitting on a case in which k to the minus 1 is much larger than the Larmor radius. So you have your large scale magnetic field and then some perturbation which is orthogonal to that, that is taking your magnetic field and bending it a little bit. And then you have a particle whose Larmor radius is much smaller than this bending. And what is this is in this plot? It's like saying that this particle is having a zero radius around like this. So effectively, what this is doing, this particle is doing, is just surfing this perturbation. You have a surfing of the wave, and then the net effect is that the direction of propagation is not changing. Suppose you are instead in the opposite limit. You are in the limit in which the scales of the perturbation are much smaller than the Larmor radius. Then again, you have your large scale magnetic field, and then you have perturbations that are like this. And your Larmor radius now is in this scale here. So again, what the particle does is that it doesn't see the perturbation. So to have a significant variation of the direction, you really need to have this matching of k to the minus 1 with the Larmor radius. So in that case, you have something that is of this kind, and your particle is trying to do a gyration that is of that kind, the two matches, and then you can get out of this perturbation with a direction that is significantly changed compared to the incoming direction. So once you have that, you have a variation of your direction on a time scale that is a typical time scale, which is of the order of this 1 divided by k resonance, omega. K resonance, P of K resonance. And what we did is just to look at this in a frame that is the frame in which these alpha and waves are sitting. But now, so in the frame of the alpha and waves, you have isotropization of the pitch angle on a time scale which is of this kind, but this is equivalent to go back to the lab frame and have a scattering of the particle in real space. So you will have a scattering length that is of the order, the propagation length, which is of the order of the velocity of the particle times this tau scale. And then you will have a analogously to pitch angle diffusion, you will have a real space diffusion coefficient, which is of the order of this variance, say in one dimension of delta z per unit time, and that will be what? It will be just of the order of this lambda squared divided by tau, so this will be of the order of v squared times tau, and again this will be of the order of v squared divided by omega k resonance p of k resonance. Okay, so we find the isotropization of pitch angles in the Alfvén wave frame. We find Brownian motion diffusion in real space. So this connection here between this DXS and the pitch angle diffusion coefficient. Here it's sort of heuristic level, but would I have, at least a couple of hours, I could derive it in more detail on the blackboard. Let me give you at least a flavor of what really one does. So now, what you have to do is to really take an ensemble of particles, just not one particle. So describe the ensemble in terms of the phase space distribution function for the species. This will be something that will depend on x, on position, on momenta, on time. And then what you have to do is to sketch the probability of having this scattering of momentum P into P plus delta P within this what we just sketch within this so to say pitch angle diffusion. Okay, as I said, that is not terribly hard, but would require a little time. So let me give you a flavor of the result. Flavor of the result is the following. First, do it. It's particularly, it's essentially the same exercise I did before, but just encoding better this transition probability and an ensemble of state. If I do it in the Alfvén wave frame, okay, so I have something that is of the following form. Get a partial derivative of with respect to time of f plus some diffusion, the convection term v scalar df over dv. And this is equal to 1 half some diffusion in momentum term, so some something that looks like a diffusion coefficient, then this is applied to the derivative in momentum of the phase space density. So that is what I would define just like d over dp of dpp df over dp, so some pp diffusion coefficient. And really, you understand here the connection with what I did before, no? Before I started like that, and then I observed that momentum are not change in modulus. So if I do the same in one dimension as I did before, this is just d over d mu of the same pitch angle diffusion coefficient I introduced before, and a derivative with respect to pitch angle. So this is in this frame. It's slightly more lengthy to go formally from the Alphen wave frame to the lab frame. So in the lab, so to speak, in the galaxy frame, then effectively what you get for this equation, I forgot to say, this equation is really familiar, right? Because this equation has a form which pretty much looks like on the left-hand side is like to have a Liouville operator acting on this term, on F. And this right-hand side is like having some kind of collisional operator. So this is really looking like a Boltzmann equation for F. Then when I translated into the galactic frame, the feature that it takes will be similar. So I have again a Liouville operator. So I have some velocity u df over this dx. What did I write here? I told you, shout at me. So you have this term there. Then this comes in. So in this u, I'm hiding the fact that there is this mismatch in velocity between the alpha wave frame and the galaxy frame. So you have this term which corresponds to the alpha velocity plus some kind of overall convective effect. if you have that the full plasma is actually having some preferred direction in the galaxy frame. So that's why I wrote it more generally than just plugging in VA there. This bulk motion, what it does is to induce a term which corresponds to adiabatic losses. Which takes this form. And then this right-hand side, really the isotropization of pitch angle in the alpha and wave frame is, as I was saying, an effect of spatial diffusion in the lab frame. So you get it in a form which is this one. Where now there is a connection between the diffusion, spatial diffusion coefficient and the pitch angle coefficient, diffusion coefficient, which again, one can derive with some care, and in one dimension is just taking a form which is the one that I sketched before. The right numbers are, you have a V squared divided by 8, my integral in pitch angle from minus 1 to plus 1 of this 1 minus mu squared squared divided by the mu mu. Okay, and this is essentially the structure that has the equation that describes spatial diffusion plus convection for charged particles in an environment which is this setup with large scale magnetic fields and small perturbation on tops. In reality, there are some extra term that, so let me put this on the left-hand side with a minus sign. In reality, there are some extra terms that one has to add when one thinks about the physics more carefully. For instance, there is an effect that comes in this Liouville term by noticing that you have an acceleration term. And why is it the case? So you have these magnetic inhomogeneities that have some velocity with respect to this frame. So you have a magnetic field that is moving compared to the frame in which you do physics. So a time-varying magnetic field is perceived as an electric field in this galactic frame. So you can have an acceleration effect which is connected to this time-varying electric field. And in fact, you get a term that you can write in this form, 1 over p squared, d over, now this p is the modulus, which, so it's an acceleration, so you have a change in the modulus, and you have it in a form which is really like having diffusion in momentum, with, again, a diffusion coefficient. And this diffusion coefficient will be related, as I said, to this velocity of the alpha waves with respect to the galactic frame. So it's something that goes with this velocity A squared and divided by the spatial diffusion coefficient, and then to get correct dimension, you have a p squared there. Okay, so you have a direct link between the two, since they are connected to the same physical effect. Then you can have a term which is related to kind of net energy losses. We were talking yesterday about electrons losing energy by synchrotron radiation or by Bragg-Stralong or by inverse Compton. So you will have to put in a term which takes that into account, and that will go with a coefficient that is like this. You have a p squared, and then this is dp over dt, which is this continuous loss rate, and then this is applied to f. And finally, I put on the right-hand side the fact that you have sources of your cosmic rays. So there will be some source, eventually depending on x and momentum. And you may have some losses, which is related, for instance, to the fact that you have a primary particle that is generated into a generating a secondary. So from the point of view, the primary is gone, so the secondary is in this source. The fact that you lose the primary will be in putting here a term which is proportional to f, and then to normalize to some loss time scale. Okay, so I took the wall backward to write the master equation for describing the diffusion of cosmic rays into the galaxy. So the jargon is that, okay, you have this df over dt. Sometimes we look at the case in which there is equilibration between sources, the number of particles that you get from the sources and the number that escape from your diffusion volume. So in the static limit, we just put this to be zero. So that's the condition we use in most solution of the diffusion equation. There is this term here, which, as I said, is some term which describes convection. So you have a particle which gets glued to some wind of plasma and is carried away from the diffusion region. While it does that, you have this term that corresponds to adiabatic losses. You have this term which corresponds to spatial diffusion. You have this term which corresponds to some kind of energy diffusion. And the jargon here is to call this term reacceleration term, because this term is a term that effectively can give you acceleration of cosmic rays along propagation, except that I'll show you tomorrow that this cannot be the main acceleration source for cosmic rays. So cosmic rays are accelerated in the sources, most likely. And then we call it re-acceleration because it's some slight bump on top of the initial spectrum, which scales with this alpha and velocity squared. So it depends on whether in your model you have larger alpha and velocity or that's negligible. And again, these terms, I already wrote what they are, the energy loss term, the source, and the species loss. Okay, so with some effort and taking some shortcut, we got to this master equation. Then I would like to give you a flavor for this what this equation implies for what you observe for cosmic rays. First of all, I should rewrite. In most cases, we are not really interested in phase-based distribution function, but we are more interested in number density for cosmic rays. That is number per momentum interval. So one introduces a variable n, which is nothing but the integral over all angles in the momentum space of this phase-based distribution function, which said was depending on like this. And then you multiply by p squared. That gives you the number of particles in p plus delta p and in unit volume. So I should just take this equation and do that kind of integration. Okay, it's not that interesting that I write it on the blackboard. But let me jump to some specific solution of this equation. So let me assume first that I have an example in which what I look for is some source which is dependent on time. I will take an impulse for the source. And let me assume that spatial diffusion is the only relevant effect. So I have a variation of n with time, and then this term here, which just gives me spatial diffusion, and I also suppose that is constant in x. So I can take the diffusion coefficient out of the derivative, and I get d Laplacian of n equal to this source function of t. So this is a particularly simple equation for which I can just get the Green function. The Green function of this equation is what? It's just g of x t is 1 divided by 4 pi d t to the 3 halves. And then I have an exponential of minus x squared divided by 4 dt. So you have this combination of, I didn't stress it, but the dimension of this diffusion coefficient is, of course, a length squared divided by a time. So this combination dt gives you a length squared, and is the typical propagation scale squared. So if I just take, as I was saying, an impulse source, so I just take q being some delta function, some q naught that is happening at a given time in a given point. So let me just assume that this is like this. Then clearly the solution of my equation, I just have to integrate over space and time this green function. So I get that the solution is q naught divided by 4 pi d t minus this t naught to the 3 half, and then an exponential of minus x squared 4 pi 4 d t minus t naught. Okay? So it's something that looks like this. So this is in a case we can apply to a solar flare effect, a solar flare event. So what's a solar flare? You get a magnetic reconnection on the sun and the burst of particles that are coming out of the, from the sun. So you have a monitor of the sun that receives this burst. And then you see there is some typical scale over which the number of particles has this sharp increase. And then you have this exponential blow off. Okay? So a model like this fits very nicely an event like that. For instance, you have only one parameter that you have to adjust. Okay, putting this x to be the distance from the sun, one astronomical unit, you get that this diffusion coefficient in the sun environment at this energy, which is pretty low energy, is something of the order of 10 to the 22 centimeters squared second minus 1. Okay. That's nice. Let's try to have some other example, which still is a simplified limit, but discusses something we are more after too, that is galactic cosmic rays, secondary, primaries, what's going on there. So the second example I want to take is the limit of so-called leaky box. In the leaky box approximation, you just take the same equation I wrote before. And what you do is to bargain this term here. Instead of looking at in detail what is happening and as a spaced diffusion, you bargain this term in terms of a time of confinement. So you take the galaxy as some kind of black box, and what you are going to estimate here is how much time the cosmic rays are staying in the box before leaking out from its boundary. So you go from this equation to an equation in which you have dn over dt plus n divided by this diffusion time, which is a function of momentum, and that's q. And clearly here you cannot discuss any spatial variation, so you have a source which just depends on p. Suppose you are also in the steady state limit. Okay, so the idea is the one I was telling you before. This is a game in which you have sources that are filling in the box, and you are reaching some equilibrium at which the rate of injection is compensated by the rate of leaking out of the blocks. So you just have that this, you set it to zero. And then, okay, the solution of this is trivial. You have that the number density is just the source function times this diffusion time. Depends on P. Okay, so why is this interesting at all? Well, because this is the simplest scheme which describes this Gramage setup for primary over secondaries that I was touching on yesterday. Because now I can plug in the fact that for a secondary component, the number density of the secondary component is going to be the source function of the secondary times this diffusion time. And so this is something that is going to be proportional to the conversion probability of a primary into a secondary times the number density of the primary component times this diffusion time. And then obviously you have instead that for the primary component, okay, when you look at the secondary over primary, then that's just proportional to this diffusion time. Which in turn is going to be proportional to the inverse of the spatial diffusion coefficient. Okay? So you have this match here. So if I take the diffusion coefficient to be some generic function of rigidity of the particle, so I'm the rigidity of the particle is defined just as the ratio between the momentum of the particle and the charge in a unit of electron charge. So this is just the Larmor radius times the larger scale magnetic field. So as we were discussing before, the microphysics is connected to this resonance on Larmor scales. So I expect that if that is the mechanism which is setting the diffusion propagation, I will have a diffusion coefficient which will mainly depend on this rigidity. And let's say that this is just a power law. So it's D naught, which multiplies R divided by some rigidity scale, that we take 3 gigawatt to some power delta. I can go back to this plot, and as we were seeing yesterday, this plot is connecting a secondary to a primary component, and you see, yesterday I was normalizing somewhere here, but really you have the dependence of this ratio that at the energies which are fairly large is indeed some kind of power law. Okay? And then if I take this justice plot and normalize this result here to this observed ratio, I find out that for the diffusion coefficient, I have a scaling that is of the order of delta 0.5 and a normalization that here is of the order of 10 to the 28 centimeters cube second minus 1. So I'm predicting a scenario in which I have a source of a primary component that is something that will scale with some power law in energy. This source of primary corresponds to a net equilibrium distribution of primary which will scale like this energy minus alpha, and then you have this steepening with T diffusion, so a factor, an extra factor of delta, and a secondary component which scales like e to the minus alpha minus 2 delta. So that's the general pattern. And what people do is to try to solve the diffusion equation in a scenario which is as much realistic as possible, still being computationally okay. So for instance, the typical approximation one makes is the following. You take, you model the galaxy like a diffusion region, and this diffusion region is defined in a cylindrical box. What's the extent of this cylindrical box? Well, this is the region that we think is filled by this stochastic component of magnetic field, which does the job of diffusing cosmic rays. The regular component is on a much larger scale, but the stochastic component we think is connected to the sources of cosmic ray itself, so it's dying out when you go away from the sources. The sources we think are sources distributed in the disk of the Milky Way. There is some distribution of most probably supernova remnant, as we will discuss tomorrow, that is sitting within as the stellar disk of the galaxy. And within this thin layer here, there is also the gas density, which is the one that is doing the job of converting primaries into secondaries. And then one puts in some assumption for what you expect for the spatial diffusion coefficient in this volume, what you expect for reacceleration in this volume, whether you expect that there is some collective effects which take your cosmic rays and drives it out from the source region, so some bulk velocity which convects cosmic rays out of the disk. You put in numbers for what you expect for cosmic ray energy losses, and so on and so forth. You take the equation, you put it into a computer and try to solve it as carefully as one can. Again, one can also take the approach of going to simplified models, and for instance, this is this leaky box is a model in which we suppressed the spatial dimension, but you can actually solve this diffusion equation on more general grounds. So, taking constant diffusion, and then you have a term like this. You can keep convection. So you have this U, df over, say that convection is in the vertical direction, out from the source gas disk, then you would have a term like this. Okay. You have the adiabatic loss case. If you have this, but let's don't put it. And then you have this source function. Suppose, for instance, that the source function, again, depends just on Z and P. Then what you do is to solve this equation with the boundary condition that at the maximum radius corresponding to diffusion, this RD over there, radius R equal to RD, or when you meet the condition for Z being equal to this large H, that is the vertical size of the diffusion box, you set the density to zero. So this means that once you reach the boundary of the diffusion box, the particle just escapes. Then this is a situation in which you can solve again for n analytically. I could write the solution on the blackboard. Since time is short, let me write at least one result which is interesting, which is that in this model I can compute explicitly what I was using yesterday, the grammage of cosmic rays at a given energy, or actually rigidity, R. So you compute it is equal to NH, the density of gas in this thin disk. This thin disk is supposed to have a height small h, which is much smaller than big H. And it's a grammage, so I have to plug in a mass, which is the mass of the proton, as a velocity, and here I'm normalizing to twice the modulus of the convective parameter there, and then you have a 1 minus the exponential of minus u big H divided by d of rigidity. Okay? So this is something you can work out in some half an hour of calculation. So there are, I'm finishing soon. There are here two effects that I left on this diffusion equation that I would like to compare. You see, when you have that, so there is this combination U versus D over H. When you have that the velocity U is much larger than this D over H, then this exponential goes to a small number, and you get this constant path length. You get the path length doesn't depend on rigidity. Okay, so in this limit here, you have x, which is not x of r. In the opposite limit, instead, you have that, which is the more important, more interesting one. You have that u much smaller than d over h. You see, I do the Taylor expansion in first order, and then I get the dependence of on u, which is dropping. So I get x of r, which is nh, h m p v divided by 2u times u h divided by d. Okay? So I can group the path length in terms which are what I was using yesterday for my naive estimate of the path length itself. So I have rho of the gas, which is this product here, times h. I normalize this small h over big H. And why do I do that? I do that because, you see, the cosmic rays are diffusing part of the time in the region where you get conversion of primaries into secondaries, this thin disk. But most of the time in the larger region where this conversion doesn't happen. So this is the density rescaled on the time. So this is the mean density that cosmic rays sees along propagation. So the density in the disk rescaled by the time fraction we stay in the disk. Yes. Okay. Sorry. Then there is a velocity, and then there is this combination here, h squared divided by 2d of r. Okay? So again, this is the combination which corresponds to my diffusion time. And you see, we can go back to this plot here and have again what I was sketching before with this diffusion time that at high energy. So if you have a finite U, you will have, since this D is increasing with rigidity, you are going from a high energy regime to a low energy regime, actually low energy to high energy. At high energy, I'm fitting up this slope and finding what is the diffusion coefficient. Low energy, I will be sensitive to other kind of effects rather than spatial diffusion, for instance, convection, or if you have reacceleration, you can fit reacceleration, and so on and so forth. So I apologize for being over time. Almost on average with respect to other speaker, but let's stop here and continue tomorrow.